馆长。接下来要上场的是加拿大专家史蒂芬·道恩斯。2008年，史蒂芬·道恩斯和乔治·西门子共同提出了 MOOC 概念，所以他被称为幕后之父。现在，他是加拿大国家研究委员会高级研究员。他今天带来的报告主题是《数字时代教育教学如何突破围城》，有请史蒂芬先生。
Thank you, and welcome. It's an honor to be able to talk to you today.
This is my
first time in China, my first time in Beijing, my third day. It's been very interesting and very wonderful, so thank you for the invitation.
感谢大家，这是我第一次来到中国，来到北京。今天是我来到北京的第三天。我在这里的一切都让我感到非常的有趣，然后呢今天也是非常荣幸能够在这里和大家交流我的想法。
My work with the National Research Council of Canada is about the technology of learning, but also the method and process of learning.
我在加拿大国家顾问委员会的工作是有关教育技术以及教育技术相关的咨询。
We've been working in the field at the NRC since 2000, and my own involvement with Assiniboine Community College and the University of Alberta stretches back another 15 years.
我在加拿大国家咨询委员会的工作，从2001年开始，一直到现在，都是有关教育技术相关的内容。
It has been a time of change, a time of transition, and a time of greater opportunity, both for society and for the individual learner.
在这段时间之内，社会发生了巨大的变化和变革。
Today I'll talk about some of that history.And some of the thinking that lies behind that history, and where we are now, and where we are going in the future.
今天的场合下，我将和大家探讨过去、现在和未来。
When I was a young man, not that many years ago, I developed a learning management system at Assiniboine.
当我还是一个年轻人的时候，很多年前的时候，我创建了一个学习管理系统。
This is a diagram of that system that we developed.
这是当时管理系统的整体的一个规划。
And it, like other learning technology at the time, was based on the concept of learning objects.
这个管理系统是基于学习对象。
The concept of learning objects was defined as any entity, digital or non-digital, that can be used, reused, or referenced during technology-supported learning.
这个学习管理系统当中的学习对象的定义呢，是在基础知识的学习当中可被使用、重复使用或被参考引用的数字化或非数字化的任何实体。
It sounds like cold, hard technology.
听起来就好像十分的冰冷，这个概念。
But in reality, it reflects the idea that at the core of education, there is something that we are creating and that we are passing on.
但实际上呢，这个概念它实际上是在学习过程当中，我们能够创造一样。学习的构建，然后呢，可以把这个学习构建多次的重复使用，传递给别人。
And it also reflected the idea that education is not a seamless whole, but composed of things that we put together.
同时，这也告诉我们，教育并不是一个无缝衔接的一个整体，而是由多个组成部分组成。 的。
Wayne Hodgins from the United States spoke about learning objects as being like Legos, blocks used to construct a course.
Wayne Hodgins 指出，学习对象就好像乐高积木一样，可以被自由的组合。
David Wiley talked about them being like atoms from which we make molecules and compounds.
而戴维·维利则提出，学习对象就像原子，我们可以对它进行组合。
What this represents is the first attempt to try to use technology to do things we were unable to do before the technology became available.
这是我们当时在技术还没有被更多的人获得的时候，对于技术的一个远景设计。
Another thing that technology allowed us to do that we were not able to do before.
另外一个技术让我们曾经想但是不曾能够实现的事情是
is to create these learning objects or to create digital resources generally
是将学习对象创造出来作为一个资源
in such a way as to be able to share them among each other
以便于人们之间能够共享这样的一个学习对象。
Of course, traditionally was thought as though it were a book.
过去我们在学习课程、教课程的时候，就像是一本书。
You would begin at the beginning and move through the different chapters in a certain regimented order.
从书的开始部分逐步的向后，按照顺序这样来教。
But the possibility of creating and sharing digital objects allowed us to think of learning resources differently.
但是现在有了创造学习对象这样一种可能性之后呢，我们就可以对于教育进行另外一种思考。
And we began to stop thinking of them as vehicles that carry learning content.
我们把学习对象当作是学习内容的载体。
And to start thinking of them as words in a conversation that we were having.
将学习对象当作是我们大家在进行对话的时候所使用的词汇。
And it was the beginning of the transformation of learning from projection of content.To a working with content among ourselves.
这样的一个转变，也是从原来对于内容的一种投射，现在转变成我们之间可以对这个内容进行共享。
This gave rise to the phenomenon we now call the massive open online course.
这也是慕课的缘起。
Or MOOC.
慕课也就是大规模开放在线课程。
It was developed by George Siemens and myself.
慕课当时是由 George Siemens 和我一起来创建的。
With the assistance of Dave Cormier and many other people.
同时，我们的同事当中还有 Dave Cormier 和其他人。
And the meaning of a MOOC is found in the name of the MOOC.
大规模开放在线课程的意义和它的名字，在可以在它的名字当中就有所指示。
The MOOC is first of all massive.
首先它是大规模的。
Not massive in the sense that it has many people in it, though it does.
并不是指学习慕课的人数有多大。
But massive in the sense that it is designed to accommodate many people.
而是指它在设计的时候就有意能够让更多的人得以学习。
It is structured not like a traditional class with a teacher and some students, but rather like a network of people interacting with each other.
并不像是一个传统的教室，有老师有学生。而是学生之间可以互相的交流。
The MOOC is also open.
慕课也是开放的。
This is fundamental to the design.
这是慕课设计的根本。
When we offered our first MOOC, our objective was to allow anybody in the world to participate in our course.
最初我们设计慕课的时候，我们的目标是让世界上所有的人都有机会参与这个课程。
It was intended to be free, that is, without cost.
当时我们的想法是免费课程。
Also free in the sense that the manner of participation was up to the individual.
同时，这里的自由也表示内容开放，没有任何限制。
The MOOC was also online.
慕课同时也是在线的。
We encouraged people to have local events, and many people did.
我们鼓励参与者组织本地化的活动，很多人也这么做了。
But the course itself was completely online.
但是课程主要还是在网络上。
And then finally, it was a course.
最后，慕课是一个课程。
That may seem redundant.
可能听起来这像是一句废话。
But the sense here is that it had a beginning point and an ending point.
但是慕课同时也有一个起点，有一个终点。
It was not something that was ongoing.
并不是无穷无尽的持续下去。
It was like having a temporary community people could join for a short while.
好比是一个暂时性的社区，大家可以暂时性的参与进来。
These were the dynamics that created the MOOC.
这就是慕课当初被创建的时候所包含的因素。
The structure of the MOOC, or the design of the MOOC, as illustrated in the picture here, was again not like a book and not like a traditional course.
慕课的结构，慕课的设计，就像大家现在在这张图表当中所见的，并不是像一个传统的课堂，传统的课程。
This design was in order to accommodate the basic premise of the MOOC.
这里的这个图表是为了将慕课的基本元素进行一个描画。
The design is that of a network. It is that of a community.
慕课的设计是有关网络，是有关社区。
It is like an environment where you can go from place to place and explore.
就好比是一个环境，大家可以从一个地方走到另一个地方，不断的去探索。
The idea was for the instructors to offer a series of events, or as we would say traditionally in English, a course of lectures.
这里呢，课程的教师需要像我们在传统课程当中所讲的，需要去创建一系列的课程。
The participants in the course were responsible for their own education during the course.
而学生在整个过程当中需要对自己的教育负起责任。
The instructors did not provide the pedagogy. The students provided the pedagogy for each other.
教师并不在慕课当中传递一种教学法理念，学生互相之间传递一种教学法理念。
They would create their own organization or their own methods of collaboration.
学生这样呢，是通过组建社群或者社团来进行协作互动。
They would also bring and were encouraged to bring their own resources or their own materials from outside the class.
学生也被鼓励分享课外的一些资源。
The idea was that each person in the course would have a different perspective or a different point of view.
这样做呢，不同的人有不同的视角，不同的观点。
And it was from these different perspectives that the learning and the knowledge produced in the course would arise or emerge.
这样做假以时日，就可以帮助学生逐步的形成个性化的思想与观点。
Now as time went by,
随着时间的推移，
there were in the United States developed an alternative form of MOOC.
在美国出现了慕课的一个变体。
So So our MOOC came to be called the C MOOC or Connectivist MOOC.
我们的慕课设计被称之为 C MOOC 或者叫关联主义引领下的慕课。
And as I said, our MOOCs were based on networks and communities.
我们的慕课是基于网络和社群的。
The MOOCs that were developed in Stanford and in other U.S. universities came to be called the X MOOC.
而由斯坦福大学以及其他大学所开创的慕课，把它称之为 X 慕课。
These MOOCs resemble the traditional course.
这些慕课和传统的课堂非常像。
They were based on video production.
他们的内容主要依赖于预先录制好的视频。
And so the content of those MOOCs became the focus.
在这些课程当中，课程的集中的要素是课程的内容。
So we have two very different visions of education, community and content.
在这里我们有了两种非常不同的关于教育的愿景，一个是基于社群的，而另外一个是基于课程内容的。
The other thing that characterized the U.S. MOOCs was commercialization.
美国后来出现的 X 慕课另外的一个特征就是商业化。
Our objective was to create community and promote learning. Their objective was to create content and sell and raise revenue.
我们的慕课是为了创造社群并且推动学习，而他们的慕课呢是用来商业化来卖课。
And that brings us to the state of the MOOC today.
这就是我们看到了慕课的现状。
The people who launched the X MOOC in the United States, people like Sebastian Thrun, for example.
People Group 在美国创建了 X 慕课。
They've been saying that the time of the MOOC is over and we're moving beyond that.
他们指出慕课的时代已经结束了，我们现在已经要走向新时代。
But I don't agree.
但是我完全不同意。
I look at 58 million students in 700 universities, and I think MOOCs are very healthy today.
我看到了约5800万人正在学习慕课，同时呢，有300多家大学正在推出不同的慕课。我觉得慕课的时代还远远没有过去。
And these numbers do not include the MOOCs I've been learning about here in Beijing.
这个数字当中还并不包括我在今天在北京看到的大家所做的慕课。
What is surviving, I am seeing, is the concept of open online education.
留存下来的，就像我所见到的，是在线学习这样的一个概念。
And I think this reflects the unique value, the unique possibilities of the internet.
我觉得这是对于互联网本身所独特的特征的一种映射。
Where it allows us to work together as a network.Rather than simply viewing or receiving a broadcast.
互联网能够帮助大家，让我们大家能够在一个网络当中互相学习，而不是仅仅得到课程的一个广播。
So now we look at where technology is going to go in the future.
现在我们来看一下技术的未来。
I believe that we will continue with open online education.
我相信开放式的在线教育仍然有它的价值。
But that we are looking at an expansion of open online education beyond the traditional community of the school and the university.
但是开放式的在线教育现在已经不再限制在大学内部。
Wei Wei Ge talked about distance education as lifelong learning.And he talked about distance education is not just university education, but going into the villages and helping people.
韦斯港今天谈到了， 开放式的学习不仅仅是针对高等教育，同时呢也要向贫困人群这样进行映射。
And this, of course, has always been the objective of open educational resources and MOOCs in general.
这也是我们对于教育资源的，尤其是慕课能够帮助大家对教育资源进行推广的一种特征。
We are now looking at what in North America is called learning analytics.
现在大家看到的这张图表里面提到的是学习分析。
And these are offering the first possibilities of being able to use the digital trails that we create in order to understand how we learn.
所谓学习分析，是我们大家在学习过程当中，针对不同的特征进行跟踪、进行收集、进行分析。
I quote from George Simmons and Phil Long on this slide.
在这张幻灯片当中，我引用了 Simmons 和 Long 相关的研究。
They talk about some of the different types of learning analytics that are currently being developed.
在他们研究当中，他们描绘了目前不同种类的学习分析。
Some of them are supporting a traditional model.
其中的一些和之前的传统模式之间有关联。
Things like, for example, sequencing resources as though when they were a book.
比如说，其中有关。
Some of them look at the students as a community and look at social network analysis.
其中有一些是有关基于行为推荐的内容序列，而其他的呢，则是有关自适应学习，比如说社交互动、学习活动和助学。
But again, we are seeing the two approaches. On the one hand, that of helping learners as communities, and on the other hand, thinking of learning as organizing content.
在这里，我们仍然能看到两种不同的想法，其中一个是网络化的，学员之间互相互动的学习，而另外一个是由技术为主导的，对于学习的一种辅助。
With respect to both sides, we can look at the outcomes of learning as well.
把刚才那两种阵营下的观点，大家如果都记在头脑当中，现在呢，我们换一个视角，来看一下学习的产出到底是什么。
People talk about the quality of learning, talked about this morning many times.
今天上午，大家关于教育质量已经有了诸多讨论。
What is the definition of that quality?
那么到底什么才是教育质量？
One way of measuring it is to look at the competencies and skills that were produced.
其中一种衡量的方法就是看学习以后学生产生的能力和技能。
This is a major effort currently being undertaken in North America.
这是在北美现阶段大家考虑学习产出的时候主要的一种想法。
Where the contents of a course or a program are being represented as competencies or skills to be obtained from that course or program.
课程当中关于学习将来的一个产出是我们对于课程内容的一种代表。
Again, though, the question is, are we simply trying to deliver competencies and skills, or are these things that people have to develop for themselves?
这里的问题，同样也是我们到底是想让学生养成某种能力和技能，还是我们关注课程本身？
I think that learning involves much more than just mastering a set of topics or even a set of skills.
在我看来，学习绝对不仅仅是掌握一系列的技能、一系列的知识。
To become educated is to change the person themselves, to change ourselves.
作为一个教育者，我们的目标应该是将学生整体的素质进行重塑，让他成为一个不一样的人。
I think it's a very personal thing.
这对我而言是一个非常个人的想法。
I think it involves the whole person, as Zichen Lin said, and not just the contents of our mind.
就像今天早上大家提到的，其中有一个有关对于人的发展的相关论述。
It is a way of life. It is a way of seeing the world.
这是一种生活方式，这是一种世界观。
When we are educated, we look at things differently. We recognize things differently.
当我们受过教育，我们将看待事情用一种不同的方式。
And it is this greater integration with the community, with society, that we also want to evaluate when we evaluate quality.
这也是我们在衡量教育质量的时候必须要思考的。
Now, in North America, there's a great emphasis on certification and recognition of learning.
在北美，对于学习，一个非常重要的做法就是给学习颁发证书。
There's a technology you may be familiar with called blockchain.
有一个技术，也许大家熟悉，叫做区块链。
It's currently used to support digital currency such as Bitcoin.
这个技术现在正在被用于支持比特币这样的一些货币。
But as Doug Delshaw suggested, we could use blockchain in order to represent, in order to secure or verify personal learning achievements as well.
但是道格贝尔肖指出，现在区块链不仅仅可以用作电子货币。相关的证书，同时呢，也可以在个人学习当中发挥它应起的作用。
This is work that is currently being undertaken by companies such as IBM and Sony.
区块链服务现在也被索尼和 IBM 这样的公司现在正在致力于相关的提供。
The question I pose of such a system is, what would such a certificate measure?
我在这里想提的一个问题是，这样的一些证书到底衡量的是什么呢？
Does it measure the acquisition of some content, like a learning object?
他们到底是衡量对于某一些学习内容的掌握情况？
Does it measure the acquisition of a skill or a competency?
还是对于某一些能力和技能的掌握情况？
Does it measure our ability to work more progressively in society?
还是我们在社会当中不断向前进步的。
These are current questions that have not yet been answered.
这些问题我现在还没有答案。
Where I see learning going in the future, and indeed many people see learning going in the future, is toward personalization.
目前教育和学习在未来化发展上逐渐地提出一个概念，叫做个性化学习。
This is a specific recognition of the idea that learning is about personal transformation.
这里大家都认为他学习呢是为了个人的转变。
Zichen Lin talked about the educational or the education revolution, we might think of learning for an individual as a personal education revolution.
今天上午有发言人提到，学习是有关教育改革。那么现在我也想提出类似的想法。
But it depends on how we approach it.
我们要思考非常清楚，到底如何去做教育改革。
Traditionally, personalization has been about the use of technology to organize learning contents.
传统意义上讲，教育是使用传统的课程来进行推动。
The basis of it has been the recommender system that has been used for things like online commerce.
相关的机制有点像现在网络商业当中所采用的互相推荐机制。
And this is a model that depends on predefined content being organized and shaped for individual needs.
这样的一种推荐机制看起来很好，但实际上呢，可能是用一些预先设定好的内容，现在呢向学生进行推送。
The challenge for personalization, however, is to be meaningful to the individual learner.
个性化学习的挑战是学生所获取的学习内容对于学生而言是有意义的。
If the learning is not meaningful, it will not resonate.
如果学习没有意义，不能够被轻易的理解，那么学生就不能够学会。
If the learning is not meaningful, it will not transform the individual.
如果学习没有意义，不能够被理解，那么对于个体而言就不能够带来转变。
And genuine learning will not happen.
而更广义上讲的转变就不可能发生。
Learning again and education again is about much more than just presenting content to the learner.
学习以及从更广义上讲，教育绝不仅仅是向学生展示学习内容。
This is what makes it so difficult, and often what makes it so expensive.
这也是为什么学习和教育现在变得非常的困难，同时呢，也非常的耗费金钱。
To my mind, the real revolution of the MOOC was not the way it distributed content to many more people.
在我看来，慕课的发展绝不是向更多的人分发相关的学习内容。
It was rather the way in which it allowed participants to manage their own learning and to create meaningfulness for themselves.
而是学生之间，学生作为一个个体，能够管理好自己所获得的学习内容，同时呢，做好自我提升、自我转变。
In many ways, when we talk about the need in the future to focus on the teacher, we have to understand that in the future, the students become the teachers.
就像我们现在强调教师的重要性，但是大家要明白，在未来，学生将转变为教师。
In our own work, we draw a distinction between.Personalized learning and personal learning.
在我现在做的工作当中，我描述的模型是基于个体的成长与发展，而不是将大量的事实灌输给学习者，也就是一个称之为个性化的学习，而另外一个呢，称之为个人学习。
I'm not really sure how the sense of these two words translates into Chinese.
我并不太清楚刚刚我说的有关个人学习和个性化学习对于大家来说是否有区别。
I'm enjoying watching the interpreter struggle.
我非常喜欢看到我的口译员现在正在满头大汗。
And then he has to say that.
然后他还要把这句话翻译出来。
Just kidding.
开玩笑。
Personalized.Is where you take something that already exists and you shape it and you mold it.
所谓个性化学习，就是大家拿到一个已经存在了的学习内容，对它进行改变。
Personal is where something did not exist, but you create it. The person creates it.
而个人学习，则是学习内容本身并不事先存在。由学习者个人对它进行创造，对它进行改变。
The view of personalized learning is we, the institution, do the learning for you.
对于个性化学习，就好比是学习的机构现在为学习者做好了一切。
We see advertisements all the time. It's fast and easy.
就像广告里面所说的那样，这种个性化学习。既快速又便捷。
Personal learning is the idea that you do it for yourself.
而个人学习 是学习者为了自己而做工作。
In the sense that you create your own learning.
好比自己为自己创造了学习的机会。
With personalized learning, there's this idea that there's one kind of content that everybody should obtain.
对于个性化学习，就好比这里有一个学习内容，已经设定好，是大家都一样的，而且呢，每一个人都必须获取。
Personal learning is based in the idea that a person begins with a task or a project or an outcome that they wish to achieve.
而个人学习则是针对学习者自己的学习目标、自己的学习产出而形成的一个概念。
It views the purpose of learning as support for the achievement of that outcome or task.
它使学习在学习者看来是为了达成自己想要达成的目标 而设的一个过程。
In personalized learning, the role of the teacher is to evaluate you and test you.
在个性化学习当中，教师的作用是对于学生进行评价和测试。
In personal learning, the role of the teacher is to help you and support you.
而在个人学习当中，教师的角色是对于学生进行帮助、进行支持。
You see the difference in perspective, right?
大家看到这两种观点之间的差异了吧？
When we developed the MOOC, we were working toward personal learning.
慕课当初被初创的时候，我们的目标就是要达到个人学习。
It was about becoming able to learn for oneself, so that we would not have to spend the time and resources to teach you.
我们的目标是让学习者能够自己为自己的学习创造条件，而不是我们为他做好一切。
Except it wasn't so cold and calculating as that.
但是这一切并不是那么的容易。
It's about also empowering the person as a person who's able to learn and adapt to changing circumstances.
在学习的过程当中，学习者被赋予了相关的能力，他能够改变自己的学习过程，能够改变自己的学习。
It's an understanding that social well-being and personal well-being are two parts of the same thing.
这个想法和今天上午大家提到的有关社会方面的治理以及个人方面的一个提升，实际上是融为一体的。
The future development of personal learning, in my opinion, will be based on something we call the personal learning environment.
个人学习在我看来是基于个人学习环境的。
Think of your personal learning environment as being like your phone.
大家可以把个人学习环境当做自己的随身的手机。
All your learning is on your own device.
大家自己所有的学习内容都是在这部手机里。
And your learning is also a mechanism to communicate and interact with other learners.
学习本身也是一个和其他学习者之间进行交流互动的体系。
You see how different that is.From learning depicted as a course.
大家可以看到这里有多么大的不同。我们之前把学习当作是学习一门课程。
This new technology will be enabled through a network of cloud infrastructure and services.
个人学习环境将能够被个人云及服务这样一个环境进行支持。
These will be supported bywireless computing and microcomputing.
这里的支持技术依托微计算和云计算。
They're using online services today called Docker or Amazon Web Services.
诸如 Docker 和 AWS 这样的一些云服务为这样的一个服务提供了相关的基础。
These already exist.But the big difference coming in the years to come is that individuals will be able to access these.
这些服务早就已经有了， 但是现在的一个最大的区别是，学习者个人也可以获得这样的一些云服务。
Your achievements, your certificates, your skills, your competencies, etc., will be recorded in your own individual personal learning record.
学习者个人的学习成就将被学习者个人的学习记录系统进行全程的记录。
We've had too short a time today, but I thank you and I appreciate your invitation. Thank you very much.
今天的时间，非常感谢大家。
感觉还挺有意思。
让我们再次感谢史蒂芬·道恩斯先生慧眼万里给我们带来的精彩报告，同时也感谢北京外国语大学网络教育学院李晨老师的精准翻译。接下来呢，提示一下。